everybody. Good afternoon. It's Dr. Jill here live with you for a question and answer session. So good to see you today there virtually. I would love for you to say hello and let me know where you're from. Just chime in on the comments here. This will be recorded. So if you want to watch later, you can listen as well. But for now, say hello. I'm going to get to that space so I can actually see you and see your questions and answers. So if you will bear with me for just a second here, I'm going to pull that screen up so that I can actually listen at the same time and see your comments. Please let me know where you're at, where you're from, where you're listening from. I am here today to answer your questions. Anything that you want to ask me. I typically talk about gut health, mold-related illness, chronic infections. So if you have any questions on any of those realms, I am here and I am looking forward to taking your questions. So like I said, just bear with me a second so that I can get that screen up and see you all at the same time that I'm doing the live here. So please say hi, tell me where you're from. I look forward to hearing where you're from. Put in your questions, jump right in. I would love to hear from you today. And like I said, I'm just getting the screens parallel here so I can hear you. Hi, Misty. Awesome. Listening from Tennessee. Very cool. Like I said, you guys just jump right in. Tell me where you're from. Get ready for questions. And now I've got my screen here, so I should be able to see you. So let's start just a little bit about immune system and the importance of immune health. One of the things I see, hi, Rochelle. Hi, Liz. Hey, everybody. Continue just popping into the comments. Say hello. Throw in your questions. I look forward to hearing them, and I will answer as many as possible in the next 30, 40 minutes or so. So I'm here, like I said, live to answer any questions that you might have. Let me know where you're from. Pop on in there. And in the meantime, let's go back to immune system and start off with that. So immune system is so core because at the core of functional medicine, most of the cases I see are chronic infection, infectious load, and toxic burden. And between these two things, what usually happens is one or the other is imbalanced. And often if the toxic load is too much, for example, if you get into a moldy home and that mold is affecting you, it'll weaken your immune system, and old things like Epstein-Barr virus or herpes, cold sores, or old things like a tick-borne infection. You maybe got bit when you were 12 and you were doing fine until you got in a moldy house and all of a sudden you're having joint pain or brain fog or fatigue. And so I see this very commonly. And part of the equation is getting back to immune system. While I do treat Lyme disease and sometimes antibiotics are necessary, just throwing antibiotics at the problem isn't the whole issue and won't really solve the whole problem. You really have to go back to the immune system and say, what is causing immune dysfunction? How do we get the immune system back online? Because having that immune system is really, really crucial. Christine, hi Liz, hi Rochelle, hi Misty, hey everybody. Question. Christine says, what's your opinion on thiamine deficiency in relation to mold toxicity and gut issues? Well, thiamine is B1, vitamin B1. It's depleted by alcohol. So we first saw some things like Wernicke's encephalopathy and vitamin B1 deficiency in alcoholics, but it happens in many other cases besides alcohol use or abuse. And thiamine is very critical to mitochondrial function. So it can be a game changer with energy, with just anything to do with mitochondria, which would be muscle maintenance, endurance, stamina, energy, brain function. So B1 is one of those things that we don't often think about, but can be just as critical as other vitamins. I often will do micronutrient testing to see about vitamin deficiencies. There's two main labs that do that. There's probably others, but the ones that I've used are SpectraCell and the Vibrant Micronutrient Panel. The Vibrant Micronutrient Panel does both intracellular and extracellular vitamin status, and it's a blood test. So I find that to be really, really helpful. I myself do it at least once a year, maybe every other year, to check in and see if there's anything I'm deficient in. And that way, I always say test, don't guess. That way you know exactly what vitamins a patient needs. And I know probably many of you have a handful of vitamins like I do that you take every day. And it gets to be a lot sometimes. I mean, if you looked at the amount of vitamins I take every day, I probably have like 40 vitamins that I take twice a day. And I don't mind because I perform great. I feel great. No problem. But it can get expensive and hard to swallow, literally. So because of that, I think nutrient testing can be a great way to find out deficiencies and more target the types of supplementation you're doing. So hopefully that answered your question about thiamine, Christine. Hi, Misty. Questions about gut health. Recently had an endoscopy due to reflux and a feeling like something stuck in my throat and horrible pain in chest after swallowing. Results were hiatal hernia and a ring, which can happen from that. I'll talk about that in a minute. Told to take Nexium for the rest of my life. Any suggestions? Thank you for your question, Misty. So let's talk about swallowing, GERD, reflux, all this, and then some solutions to that. So first of all, what can cause heartburn? Well, I want to talk about mold-related illness and heartburn because I see a lot of patients, and many of you who are fans or followers have experienced mold-related toxicity. Mold is one of those things that can increase mast cell activation, and mast cell activation can increase production of things like histamine and prostaglandins. Histamine and prostaglandins can cause issues, and especially histamine can contribute to heartburn. So there's many other causes of heartburn, but one of them is excess histamine, and especially if MCAS or mast cell activation happens after mold exposure. So believe it or not, one of the symptoms I see after mold exposure is heartburn or GERD. So if that's the case, you need to lower histamine. That's why H1 and H2 blockers can work, things like Zyrtec or Zantec or Pepcid. And those are not a problem to take short term. Even proton pump inhibitors like the one you mentioned, Misty, Nexium, or the generic form of that can be helpful short term. They're really only indicated for about 14 days, not lifetime. If someone has Barrett's esophagitis, which can be a precancerous condition, it is indicated to be on proton pump inhibitors. But a lot of times Barrett's esophagitis is misdiagnosed and there really isn't those precancerous cells. So it's always worth getting a repeat endoscopy to see if that clears up. But let's talk about alternatives to medications like proton pump inhibitors. So things that I like to use are deglycerized licorice, glutamine powder, plantain can be helpful. Also zinc carnosine, 75 milligrams twice a day can be incredibly helpful. And I really like the combinations of powders that have glutamine and aloe and DGL. Two that you can find at drjillhealth.com would be gut calm powder and gut shield. They're very similar. So it just depends on the flavor, what you like. The gut shield comes in chocolate and vanilla, and the gut calm is just a plain flavor if you don't like the chocolate or vanilla. And all of those products can be really helpful at soothing and coating the esophagus when you have something like irritation. Now, hiatal hernia is actually a issue where the stomach comes up through the diaphragm into the place where the lungs should be. So it's like squeezing up into that. The diaphragm is like a band of muscle that prevents the stomach and the contents of the stomach from coming up into the chest. But sometimes you can have an opening, which is that hernia, it's a hiatal hernia, and the stomach can slide up into the chest cavity. And as you can imagine, it shouldn't be up there. And when it does, it creates kind of a bubble so that the food and things can kind of stay up there and reflux into the esophagus, causing heartburn. So hiatal hernia, I often recommend someone like a chiropractor or a massage therapist or a physical therapist who's been trained in the manipulation of the gut, and they can actually do a maneuver that will help that hiatal hernia stay down. That can be helpful. Otherwise, if it's severe, sometimes surgery is necessary. But things like I said, glutamine, zinc carnosine, deglycerized licorice. One of the other tricks I love is marshmallow root. You can get this as a tea or a tincture, and you can actually buy bulk marshmallow root. We have an apothecary here in Boulder where I recommend patients go, and they can buy that marshmallow root and put a couple of tablespoons in cold water and put it in the fridge in a quart bottle. And then they can just pour out a couple ounces at a time and sip that through the day. You can also make hot marshmallow root tea. And those are really good at coating and soothing the esophagus if it's irritated. They can give great relief. Another thing that can be helpful is just gentle teas and things. Peppermint in particular can decrease spasm. So a peppermint tea can sometimes be helpful for that as well. Hopefully that answered your question, Misty. Rochelle, let's see. Rochelle asked about mold causing gallbladder issues and adenomas on the adrenal glands. Sounds like you had exposure to penicillin for years and your body's shutting down. I'm so sorry to hear that, Rochelle. I'll talk a little bit about this and try to address some of those issues. So when we have mold exposure, any sort of toxin in our body often is fat soluble. It gets in our tissues. This is one of the reasons things like infrared sauna can be so helpful, because that infrared sauna penetrates the skin and allows us to kind of sweat out the phthalates, the parabens, sometimes metals, and definitely mycotoxins. And sometimes I should say maybe all the time, sweating is a real core part of detox. So if you're not sweating or you have difficulty with sweating, it's best to start gently and to start getting your body warm in a sauna or a hot bath or a hot shower and start to reorient your body to the ability to sweat. If you're super toxic, sometimes your body won't sweat at all, and that's a real problem. I usually consider patients to be pretty toxic if they've stopped sweating or if it's really hard for them to sweat. So typically with infrared sauna, I recommend starting at 100 degrees and letting it heat up to 130, and maybe getting in the sauna around 100 degrees, starting with 5 minutes and letting the temperature rise. And then maybe next time you go to 7 or 8 minutes and then 10, and you just go up slowly to see what's tolerated. If you feel absolutely drained or exhausted after the sauna, then you've probably done too much. You've probably mobilized too many toxins. I'll tell you a real quick example from my own life. Recently in August and September, I had some exposure to cadmium and got sick every once in a while. And fortunately for me, now I know how to detox. So even if I had an exposure, within 12 to 24 hours, I would feel pretty normal. However, lately when I've tried to sauna, since I've had this exposure, I think my load is a little higher, because when I do that sauna, I'll get really tired. So if I go in there for 20 or 25 minutes, I just did it last night. And normally when I stay up till 10 or 11 at night, last night I was in bed, sound asleep by 9:15. And it was partially that sauna had created this detox mobilization of toxins from the mold and made me really tired. Now today I felt fine. So it's okay to go ahead and sauna, but you want to go slow. And if you feel really exhausted or you feel like you're paying for the sauna, you probably overdid it. So start with 5 or 10 minutes, 100 degrees, work up to 130 degrees for 30 to 45 minutes. You can go up to 135 degrees, but I don't recommend generally going a lot higher than that, because at 140, 150, you intend to sweat a lot and lose electrolytes, but you're not really detoxifying as well as you would be at 100 to 130. So that's a little bit about infrared sauna. Back to your question about the gallbladder and the detox. So when you have a mold exposure, basically you use this, it's called biotransformation. It's your liver gallbladder axis. And this is why we've got the liver. I always call her the queen. We need to take care of the queen. And it's so important because the liver gallbladder is the area where your body takes toxins from the tissues, transforms them into water-soluble elements so that you can eliminate them from your body. And one of the ways this does this is mycotoxins will get released from the tissue through exercise or sweating or glutathione. And then they get put into phase one. They get stuck from phase one to phase two in this intermediate. The intermediate is actually more toxic than the original particle of mycotoxin or whatever toxin your body's dealing with. And so what happens if you ramp up phase one, coffee can do that. And at the expense of phase two, if your phase two is very slow, you may get stuck in the middle with those intermediates and feel even more toxic. So one of the things you can do is dry brushing, Epsom salt baths, infrared sauna, rebounding, anything you can do to circulate lymphatics or to help that phase two. Phase two is very reliant on leafy greens and sulforaphanes and glutathione and B vitamins and N-acetylcysteine and many, many things that you need, methionine and SAMe and B vitamins. And if you don't have all those nutrients, you may be stuck there in that intermediate and you may feel worse when you try to detoxify. So real important for all of those things. Now, all of those toxins get excreted into the bile, which gets stored in the gallbladder. So your original question that you would ask was about the gallbladder and mold toxicity. And definitely you can have sluggish bile and things that happen in the gallbladder related to a toxic load. So things that can support your gallbladder would be an herb called tudka for the liver. It will help excrete the bile. Bitters taken with meals, things like absinthe, which is one of the original bitters. We use that in Switzerland when I was at the Swiss Mountain Clinic. Quite often, actually, with every meal during the liver gallbladder detox that I spent a week there doing. This was before COVID a couple years ago, but that whole liver gallbladder are really important. And if your bile is stagnant or sluggish, you're actually holding on to toxins. One of the other key components is the enterohepatic circulation, which is our very highly efficient circulation where we reabsorb about 95% of our bile acids and recycle them. That all sounds great until you know that toxins are stored in the bile. And if you just recirculate and recycle them, it doesn't do you any good. This is where binders come in because they will help to grab a hold of the bile and escort it out of the body into the stool. So super helpful. So hopefully that explains. You can definitely have a toxic effect on both adrenals, on the gallbladder, on the liver, if you have a large exposure to mold. Okay. Hi, Taylor. Any info on exosomes? Oh, exosomes. This is in the realm of peptides, exosomes, some of the newer things that are happening. And a lot of these are signaling molecules to our body to do a certain thing. So for example, certain peptides and exosomes will tell the body to make more muscle, decrease body fat. Some of them will say increase thymus immune system function. Other ones of them will help with repair of tissues like tendons and ligaments. So there's many different ones, and these are all signaling the body to do different things and to kind of push it into a state of healing. And there's many exosomes and there's many peptides that do that specifically. Hi, Curtis from Minneapolis. Thank you for your kind words. Hi, Misty. You are so welcome. Other question about gut health. Son diagnosed with ulcerative colitis and now on a biological medicine for the rest of his life. Oh, yes, yes, yes. Many of you know I was diagnosed with breast cancer at 25, very aggressive. I went through 3-drug chemotherapy, lost all my hair, got so sick, destroyed my gut in the process. I don't have any regrets because I think it saved my life. But I've spent the last 20 years restoring my gut. And just 1 year after I finished treatment for cancer, I was diagnosed with Crohn's disease. So I can very much relate to your son's diagnosis, ulcerative colitis, and Crohn's disease. Both are inflammatory bowel conditions where the body starts to get confused. They're autoimmune diseases that basically the body starts to attack the gut lining. What we know to be true is they're slightly different. One is ulcerative colitis is more in the colon and it affects one area in the rectum or the colon where there's ulcerations. Crohn's can affect any area of the bowel from the mouth all the way to the anus. And it causes granulomas and these tissue inflammation pockets. Both can be lifelong inflammatory conditions that can really affect digestion of nutrients and pain and weight and all of these things, and can also cause fevers and other symptoms. So they can profoundly affect, and I'm so sorry that your son has to deal with that. However, in my case, I was able to look at the microbiome and really heal the gut. And I'm considered cured today. 20 years later, I have no symptoms and no evidence of the Crohn's. I remember going to my gastroenterologist back when I was first diagnosed and I was clueless. I didn't know much about it. And he point blank looked at me and said, Jill, you're going to need lifelong surgeries. You may lose your colon. You're probably going to be on biological medicines or steroids for the rest of your life. And there is no cure. And then I said, well, doctor, what about diet? Can I do anything with my diet? And he shook his head and said, Jill, diet has nothing to do with this. And I remember thinking in my gut, I didn't know a whole lot. I was a 30-year medical student, just had survived cancer. But intuitively, I thought, well, how in the world can diet not have something to do with a gut issue? And so I went out to explore and research and find answers. And I didn't take steroids and I didn't take biologics. And through much searching, I found the specific carbohydrate diet. And I thought, well, what do I have to lose, right? This is better than drugs and surgery. And I started it. And within 2 weeks, my symptoms of fevers and pain and all the symptoms that went along with the Crohn's were gone. Now, I was not cured in 2 weeks. So don't get me wrong here. But what I found out was diet does have something to do with it. And when we have Crohn's, we have a genetic predisposition towards an abnormal response to a normal microbiome. So what does that mean? For me, that meant that the chemotherapy had really induced a pathological leaky gut. It had really destroyed like artillery on the lining of my gut, destroyed the integrity of my gut lining. So all of a sudden that gut lumen, that enterocytes, the cells that line the gut that were supposed to keep the bacteria inside the gut lumen and keep that from the bloodstream had been destroyed by the chemotherapy. And unbeknownst to me, I had celiac disease and I was eating gluten. I had no idea that that was causing part of the problem, creating more permeability. So after the chemo on a gluten full diet, I was developing this massive leakage of gut contents into my bloodstream, into my immune system. And because of my genetics, NOD2 is one of the genes and there's others. My immune system was hyperreactive to that threat, that lipopolysaccharide or bacterial coating that was triggering this response. And it got confused and the immune system started to not just attack that bacteria, but to attack my own gut lining. and that led to Crohn's disease. So what I found was changing the diet, taking out gluten and taking out the triggers, not only to the inflammatory antibodies in my blood to those certain foods like gluten and dairy, and I took out sugar as well, but also stopping that inflammatory leakage of contents and stopping that inflammatory reaction. So diet did have a lot to do with it. Now, I did a lot over the last 20 years at looking at the exact contents of the microbiome and taking out healing and treating any sort of parasitic infections, any yeast overgrowth, which is also called fungal dysbiosis. If you haven't seen my blog, go right over to jillcarnahan.com, look at the last couple editions of my blog, and you'll see an article specific on Crohn's disease and fungal dysbiosis. This is something not a lot of doctors are talking about, but I wrote about it very recently. Take a look at jillcarnahan.com. Just hit the blog button on the menu, and you'll see just a couple weeks ago, I posted a very important article about this and about how that fungal dysbiosis, the yeast overgrowth, whether it's Candida or Saccharomyces, will often trigger Crohn's and colitis. So very relevant. And part of my healing was treating that fungal dysbiosis. The other thing that often happens is SIBO, small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, and the specific carbohydrate diet. One of the reasons that it works is it starves those bacteria. So you can get a decrease in bacterial overgrowth as well. Now, diet's one of the pieces. Microbial, antimicrobial herbs are another. Sometimes antibiotics, I've taken several of those in my lifetime, can be influential as well. So that's a lot on the Crohn's and colitis. The bottom line is getting to a good functional doctor that can look at the gut microbiome through stool testing, organic acids, make sure there's no other triggers like infections, toxins, et cetera, and then treating those imbalances. And I've seen many, many, many people either remission or cure of Crohn's and colitis by treating the root cause. So hopefully that helps, Misty. And I know it's hard to see your son suffer, isn't it? Oh, Rochelle, you had your gallbladder removed today. Oh, sweetheart, I hope you're healing well and resting and taking good care of yourself. So once your gallbladder removed, that's just a sac that holds the bile. And sometimes it gets so sticky and full of gunk and debris that taking it out is appropriate. So from now, though, you're going to have the liver directly common bile duct dripping bile into your small bowel. So some people after surgery, after gallbladder surgery, have a little more difficulty with loose stools and that. And I would say digestive enzymes and things can be really helpful if you've had your gallbladder removed. So I hope you heal quickly, my dear. Hi, Anna. Oh, great to see your name and face there. Happy Thanksgiving to you as well. And everybody listening, I hope you're all looking forward to a wonderful week with family or just by yourselves or whatever you're going to do and eating some healthy, wonderful foods. You know, it's funny. I'll tell you a little secret about my Thanksgiving. I'm allergic to some of the main Thanksgiving foods like turkey and cranberries. So I typically make my own salad and chicken and veggies and things that aren't really typical Thanksgiving fare because I can't really eat most of those things. However, I do have a paleo pumpkin pie. If any of you are paleo, want to make a pumpkin pie that is absolutely out of this world. It uses no cane sugar, no sugar at all, just coconut palm sugar in small amounts. And the crust is gluten-free. So be sure and check that out on my website under recipes. Look up paleo pumpkin pie and you can make your own this week if you want. Hi, Christine. Mold toxicity, sensitive to oxalates. And following antifungal protocol. Okay, so let's talk about oxalates and mold. So basically, one of the causes of excess oxalates is not breaking them down. That can be genetic. Another one of the causes in contribution to this is production of oxalates. Oxalates can be produced by yeast or mold, sometimes also by Clostridia. So many of the times the excess oxalates I see in someone that can cause pain, inflammation, interstitial cystitis, joint pain, all kinds of symptoms. It's like little shards of glass in your tissues. So as you can imagine, it's pretty painful. And oxalates can cause, like I said, the painful bladder that mimics interstitial cystitis or bladder irritation. It can cause all kinds of symptoms, joint pain, kidney issues, et cetera. And usually part of the root cause is a fungal or a mold overgrowth or excess in the body. So one of the ways that we can decrease oxalates is looking at those issues and treating either the mold issue or the yeast issue with antifungals or doing detox for the mold. Another thing that's important is oxalates are in the diet. And here's the deal. Oxalates are in very many wonderful foods like almonds and blueberries and kale and spinach. So just taking out oxalates, number one, if you go from an oxalate full diet where you're eating blueberries and almonds and spinach and all these wonderful foods, and you just stop eating those, you might dump oxalates and actually feel like you're getting worse. So I never recommend going 100 miles an hour to zero and stopping oxalates. But what you can do is be aware of oxalates in food. Look up the list. You can find one on my website under my blog at jillcarnahan.com. And you can look up the list of oxalates. And what I recommend is decreasing or just making sure in a day that you don't have a very heavy day of oxalates, because you may have more pain or inflammation. And then the root cause is getting rid of those organisms like yeast or mold or clostridia. And you're right, there are oxalate degrading bacteria, so diversity is key. One of the ways to increase diversity in the gut would be to increase use of spore-forming probiotics, increase use of prebiotics and probiotics that can help diversity, and just increasing a plant-based diet with lots of fiber and fruits and vegetables to feed those good bacteria. Diet is the number one way to increase diversity in the gut. So a probiotic won't do it by itself. You got to use diet, and you got to make sure your diet is diverse in the things that bacteria love, which is prebiotic fibers. Jerusalem artichoke and different plant fibers can be really helpful. Hi, Tracy from Minnesota. You are so welcome. And thank you for thanking me. Hi, Diego. Products, Cbotic. I have not heard of that. I think I've had a few patients using that product. I do like Biocidin. It's not always my first choice. I use a lot of different things. I'll be sure and put a few links in here, but my two favorites at drjillhealth.com are the Berberine 1000. It's a high dose berberine that can be really good for SIBO. And then also the Candida Destroyer. So you can find those at drjillhealth.com. And that combination treats both SIBO and SIFO. And that's a great way to start. Hi, Kelly. Relation between mold toxicity and interstitial cystitis. Well, I talked just a little bit about that. And that would be two things, oxalates and histamine. So oxalates are often produced by aspergillus and penicillin. So if you have a mold toxicity issue, exposure, or colonization in the sinuses or the gut, you may produce more oxalates, which can inflame the bladder and cause cystitis. And then so can histamine. And as I mentioned before, with the reflux, often, if you have a mold exposure, your body will produce more histamine because mast cells are activated. And then when mast cells are activated, you can have things like heartburn or bladder irritation from the histamine. This is why antihistamines, either natural things like quercetin, you can check out my Hist Assist at drjillhealth.com, another game changer product if you have allergies or mast cell issues or histamine issues. Hist Assist at drjillhealth.com. Recommended dose is 2 twice a day for most people, and it really will decrease that production of histamines. Other things like Benadryl, Zyrtec, Zantec, and Allegra, Claritin can all help temporarily as well. Hi, Jill Barron. Oh my gosh, great to see you here. Bless you, my dear friend. Hi, Misty. Let's see. Thank you so much. And you're right. Yes, diet does have something to do with it. Rochelle, taking new patients. Oh, you're so kind. You guys are so beautiful. I love coming here and hearing your words and your feedback and your thanks. You know what? I do have a PA. Her name is Crystal, and she is taking new patients. So if you do want to come to the clinic or do a virtual consult, you can find Crystal on my website at jillcarnahan.com. And she is taking new patients, and I review almost every single case with her. So you'll still get input from me if you see Crystal. She's amazing. It took me 7 years to find a good PA, and I'm just blessed to have her there. Hi, Misty. There's your question. Do I take telehealth? Right now, I'm closed to new patients except by referral. But like I said, I have a PA, and we're hoping to expand to more doctors in the future. So stay tuned. I know there's so many patients who are looking for a functional medicine doctor. And you can also check at ifm.org, which has functional doctors who are trained all over the United States. You can search by zip code. And you can check ICI, that's International Society for Environmentally Acquired Illness, for docs that understand mold and Lyme disease and some of those things. That's a great resource as well. Because I know if you're, depending on where you're at, sometimes it's hard to find a doc who knows how to treat these complex things. Hi, Christy. What do you recommend for Candida? So I mentioned this earlier, and I'll be sure and pop in here later. It's always kind of hard to talk and do links at the same time. But at drjillhealth.com, I have a Candida destroyer that works really, really well. I'll put a link in the chat here and wherever you're watching this from, so that if you're interested in that. And there's so many other products. Other things out there would be oregano. So I love using oregano, pau d'arco, caprylic acid, berberine, garlic, many, many things. I'll pop back in here if you just pop in and, you know, once we end the call, you'll be able to see all the links, but I'll put some more links in here about things that you can use for Candida. So great question. I do find you have to treat Candida often for months, not just weeks. So plan on being on something antifungal, maybe even 4 to 6 months. And especially if it's herbal, it works. Now, sometimes prescriptions are necessary. So you could talk to your doctor about nystatin, which is a non-absorbable antifungal, or fluconazole, which is a stronger antifungal that goes through the liver. So if you have any liver issues, you probably wouldn't want to use it, but you can use that with your doctor to treat yeast infections or overgrowth as well. And it's amazing. Many people, especially with a weakened immune system, they really have fungal issues that are systemic and need treatment. And especially if you've had mold exposure and your immune system is in a weakened state, it's super common to have fungal overgrowth that needs treatment. So do talk to your doctor about herbs and maybe even medications for that. Okay, let's just do a couple more questions here. If you guys have any more questions and you're listening, pop on in and I will answer. And let's talk just a little bit about one of my other favorite topics that you're not going to hear from a lot of doctors, and that's coffee enemas. What in the world, right? I'm going to put a link here. So here's a story. You may have heard me talk about this before, but I went to Switzerland to the Swiss Mountain Clinic for a 2-week liver and gallbladder detox. And I know some of you listening, Anna, were there with me. So you may remember, or maybe if you stay tuned in the future after this whole, you know, thing, pandemic quiets down, I will be back. And I take a group usually. So stay tuned because it's so much fun. You to spend 2 weeks with me in Switzerland with a liver gallbladder detox. And we're at this gorgeous resort. Not really a resort, it's a medical clinic, but it feels like you're a resort in the mountains, pristine, no EMFs, just lovely, lovely place. You get treatments the whole week. You get served five-star meals that are all vegetarian to rest your liver and gallbladder. And a couple of the things we did during that week were coffee enemas, colonics, treatments with ear acupuncture, auricular therapy, herbs, vitamins, nutrition. We did a gallbladder cleanse. So it's really amazing to go there and to get a detox. And back to the original question of coffee enemas. So one of the things we're not taught about this in medical school. In fact, it's not even talked about at all. And I remember being there with a population that was quite a bit older than myself and seeing them all go through this detox and do really, really well. And I was just puzzled to think about, well, why is it that they're doing so well at this intense detox and not having trouble or die-off or issues? And I realized that part of the therapies there were helping were both the colonic hydrotherapy that was usually weekly and then the coffee enemas. Because what happens is, as I talked about earlier, the liver gallbladder dump the bile into the gut lumen. And this is one of the ways we detoxify. And if you have constipation or not good bowel function or you're not eliminating regularly, that can really get reabsorbed and add to your toxic load. So surprisingly to me, I realized coffee enemas can be an important part of a detox. And when you do a coffee enema, it raises the glutathione production by the liver by about 600%. So it's a really great way to enhance detoxification. So as I came back to the US, I realized we don't really have any good kits or systems. And one of the things we had in Switzerland was this coffee enema kit that was a nice BPA-free bottle that you could just squeeze right into the enema with an instant, really clean coffee that contained charcoal. So it was so easy to use. You just put lukewarm tap water, fill it up, shake the bottle, and use it. And you could be done in 10, 15 minutes. So we now have those at our store imported from Switzerland, directly from the Swiss Mountain Clinic. And I'm putting the link here just because many people don't know about this and don't know how easy and effective it can be. So, and with the kit comes instructions and everything you need. So check that out. Okay, just the last couple of minutes, I will do another question. Kelly, International Society for Environmentally Acquired Illness, and I will put a link to them in the chat box or wherever you're watching this right now. because that is a great resource to look for doctors who understand mold related illness. I just stuck that in the box there. And let's see, we have one more question here. Margot, comment on apparent high prevalence of arsenic, cadmium, lead, and many herbs and spices. Yeah, so this is an issue, isn't it? Yeah, because we think our supplements are all clean. What I recommend, I wrote an article maybe 3 years ago on trying, sorry to say this, to avoid Amazon for your supplements, because the quality control, where they're stored, where they come from, isn't always the greatest. So it's best to get professional grade products from pharmacy doctor, some reputable location, because then you know they're stored properly. And that's one reason, like on my Dr. Jill Health web store, drjillhealth.com, you'll find only professional grade products. So stuff that I've actually resourced to make sure that there's no lead contamination or anything like that in those, because gosh, it can be tricky. And I've even been, you know, I remember us first finding out we were doing some investigation and getting product shipped from Amazon just to see. And we found like products that were discolored and probably heat sensitive that weren't properly stored. So you just want to be careful where you get your stuff and make sure it's clean. All right, everyone. Thank you so much for joining me tonight. A joy as always, even though we're virtual, sending you lots of love.